Good morning. I am Brooklyn Borough President Eric Adams, and I'm joined here with a list of organizations and black men throughout the city who are really here to voice our outrage over the recent terrorist act of a man who was killed merely because of his ethnicity. I want to take a moment. I'm joined with my colleague, Borough President Gail Brewer, who's the Borough President of Manhattan. She's on her way to another event. So I want to step aside and give her an opportunity to speak. She went off of her schedule just to come here and show her solidarity. And so I would like Gail Brewer, Manhattan Borough President, to speak at this time.
Thank you very much, my colleague Eric Adams, for bringing us together. I will be brief because today's also a day to celebrate the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire victims and what brought us together for the labor laws in the United States. And so I have to go celebrate with those wonderful labor leaders. But I'm here to stand with the African American community and others who care about our city and who are absolutely opposed to the rampant amount of hate crimes, and in this case, a murder because of hate crimes. Hate in America is something that is becoming far too prevalent, and we can all have our reasons as to why. I certainly have mine. But what you look like, who you love, where you come from, how you worship, or simply who you are, should not be something that anyone should hate and nobody should take action. And thank goodness for the good people who are here today who understand that. It's a disease that is plaguing our country more now than ever. And the murder of an individual, Mr. Timothy Caughman, who was a resident, permanent, associate degree, wonderful, creative person, somebody who was paying his rent just like all other New Yorkers. More than that, it's an outrage. We cannot allow to recede into this sea of hate. There needs to be a spotlight on it, particularly for this gentleman. And the media got his permanent residence completely wrong. They said he was homeless. He is not homeless. I know the Barbizon Hotel very well. And every American needs to know this person's name and needs to ask himself or herself, what have I done to end racism? The work of ending racism in America isn't somebody else's job. It's the job of every single American. So I'm really honored to be here. I want to thank my colleague, Eric Adams, for bringing us together. And I look forward to working together with this wonderful group of people in the future to end hate in America and end something else in Washington. But we won't talk about that now. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Gail. We're joined by another number of organizations, Faith, Father Alive in the Hood, Care New York, Noble, Reverend Eliotine, Bishop Finlay, Councilman Carnegie is also going to join us. Also, I see that Black Lives Matter is here as well. And also, Evan Bernstein from the ADL is here as well. And we will be hearing from some of them in the future. I think that, and I brought this with me, because I think we need to dramatize the seriousness of what is happening here. To have a black man walking the street of New York and to have a person travel from Maryland to hunt out and stalk a black man.
Yes, sir.
This knife is a knife of racism, but it's also a knife of terrorism. And if we merely try to isolate this incident and say, well, this is just one deranged person. No, he comes from a sea of deranged people that is swimming with the tide of Americans' philosophy right now. And if we don't address it, we are going to continue to see the swastikas, the anti-LGBT community, the hatred. We have to stop ignoring what is taking place in the tide of America right now. What happened to Timothy is an act of terrorism, and it's more than just looking at his individual action. We need to go and investigate his group, and his group should be placed on the terrorist watch group like other terrorist organizations. We need to do a thorough investigation and ensure that they are on the can't fly list in America.
That's right.
We need to look at every member of that organization and determine, should there be a thorough investigation, are they promoting terrorism in America? Because if they can stab a black man on 36th Street and 9th Avenue, then they can get up on board a plane and stab every Jewish person, every black person, every Chinese person, every gay person, everyone that don't fit into their characteristics, every Muslim. That is the hatred that's festering in this country. This was placed in the back of a person who was merely going about his daily life. And we need to understand how this impacts. That knife may have pierced the back of Timothy, but it has pierced the body of our community and has sent shockwaves through every black man that you see here. When he walks the street and hears someone walking behind him, when he hears a loud bang, a loud noise, when he hears someone yells out, this is a terrifying incident that took place. And all of us are here today, not only to voice our outrage, but we want our government on a national level to make a national comment on the seriousness of this. Every hate group in America that carries out these terrorist acts should be treated just as that, as a terrorist.
Yeah, that's right.
And I was happy to speak with the district attorney today. His office called today and stated they are going to aggressively look at this crime and aggressively prosecute it with the fullest extent of the law. Hate crime is not enough. When you commit an act that intentionally want to cause terror in a group of people, that is a clear definition of terrorism.
Yes,
right. It doesn't matter if you use a bomb, if you use a car, if you use a gun, or if you use a knife. Terror is terror. And terrorism is something that should not be accepted in America. It should not be accepted in New York. And it should not be accepted on 36th Street and 9th Avenue. And it should not be accepted anywhere in this country. What happened in London is wrong. It was terrorism. And what happened at 36th and 9th Avenue was terrorism. And sugarcoating the classification is not going to take away the terrorist that was felt and the terror that was felt throughout our community. Every black man felt that knife in the back of Timothy, and we want a thorough investigation into the organization where he was born from that gave birth to that, because there are more like him that are being born every day, and they need to be addressed, and they need to be investigated, and they need to be treated as a terrorist organization and the full brunt of the law. They are no different than ISIS right here in America, and they need to be treated like ISIS. You cannot leave America and join ISIS, then you cannot stay in America and join a hate group that plunges a knife in the back of an innocent person. We want a few representatives to speak as well. We want a representative that's here from Father Alive in the Hood. Kenny Carter is doing some amazing thing with young men throughout the city, and it just makes his job even more difficult. I'm Kenny Carter.
I'd like to say that we stand here together. It may not look like numbers to you, but I believe each and every individual here represent over 100 people by themselves. We have individuals that are at work right now and they can't partake in this particular rally. It was an emergency rally that the good brother sent out email blasts, phone calls, and just try to gather the attention of those who need to really pay attention. He spoke of acts of terrorism. Not only the murder of the brother Timothy, whom I have not known until he got murdered, is an act of terrorism, but also young girls in D.C. Over 10 girls have been kidnapped in D.C., black and Latino girls. To me, the signs are kind of coinciding with one another, because these are all happening within this week span. We have to communicate as such, but the relationships have to be rebuilt and reestablished in our communities. Because for a man to be walking aimlessly, well, he had an aim, as well as the individual shall remain nameless, because he came to New York just to get the notoriety and the publicity that he's getting. So we're gonna say he's nameless, but the brother Timothy, he should have had somebody, yo, what are you doing? Somebody should have been able to give him a warning, but a lot of us in New York, what do? We don't say nothing to each other, we casual head nods and we keep it moving. I would hope from this day forward that we can be our own alert system if we see something that's going on. Brother, watch your back. Well, move the brother out the way. Somebody say something, because I'm sure the brother was unaware of his attacker. And for it to be just a random person, it could have been any one of us here going to work, going to pick up your child, doing something responsible as fathers, brothers, uncles, grandfathers. This is what we do. This is an atrocity. This is an animalistic mentality that has to be caged. I can't begin to express how I truly feel. But what I'm speaking of right now, I'm sure the energy that is being projected is felt. This has to stop, because every action causes a reaction. So now we have to really focus on what's the reaction to this heinous action. In closing, my name is Kenny Carter. I represent my organization, which is FAITH, Fathers Alive in the Hood. Thank you guys, and appreciate y'all all for coming out.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Carter. And representing the National Organizations of Blacks in Law Enforcement, that is the executive offices of the law enforcement throughout the country, Derek Powell.
Yes, good afternoon. I'm here as a representative of Noble, but I'm also here as a 30-year veteran of the NYPD. And this was my boss for 30 years, and we worked for 30 years to make this city a safe city. It is still one of the safest cities in the world. But when acts like this happen, we have to stand up and let the world know that we live locally, we have to interact globally, and we have to fight terror wherever it is. If it's on the streets of New York, we're going to continue to do what we've done for the last 30 years to seek it out and rid it from this city. So thank you all for coming out.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And our partners here not only deal with the African-American community, we have here also a good friend, Mr. Evan Bernstein from the ADL. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to the Borough President. I'm Evan Bernstein. I'm the New York Regional Director for the Anti-Defamation League. And I'm afraid that I have more questions than answers today. How can this be New York City in 2017? We at the Anti-Defamation League want to share our sympathies, and we share in your pain and grieving and outrage around this racist murder of an innocent black man. We all believe that all Americans have a stake in responding to bigotry and racism, and we stand with you. We say loudly and forcefully that this violence has no place in our city, our state, or our country. We will continue to speak out, work to prevent and educate against the targeting of all minorities in America. In the last few months, we have stood together too many times following hate crimes. We've spoken out together when the LGBT community was targeted. We have spoken out together when the Muslim and other religious communities have been targeted. We have spoken out together when the Hispanic community was targeted. We have spoken out together when the Jewish community was targeted. And now today, we speak out loudly for the Black community. We know from our history that hate does not stick to one target. If one of us is targeted, we are all being targeted. And we must continue to stand together against this kind of hate and speak out every time it happens. Every time. This cannot become the norm. If we don't stand up here every single time, it's going to become the norm. And it cannot happen. It cannot happen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And that's well said, because we're seeing good people from all over the country of different faiths and beliefs coming together. And we also have members of the Muslim group, Care New York. Care New York?
Care New York.
First and foremost, we want to convey our sympathies to the loved ones of Brother Timothy Caughman. And we want to let them know that we mourn beside them. I'm going to let Albert Kahn speak on behalf of the Council on American Islamic Relations, but before I do, I want to let my African American brothers know that they don't stand alone, that we are, in fact, one community, and that the Muslim community has had, unfortunately, its own entanglements, its own travesties, its own experiences with hate, and that's been perhaps emphasized even more with this administration. But let's not forget that the Muslim community is also diverse. One third of Muslims are African American brothers and sisters. And so they are our community. And every community that's targeted is my community. And I stand here, perhaps within the sorrow, but also in defiance and resistance of the hatred and bigotry that wants to overwhelm us. And I reject it with love and solidarity for my brethren here. Albert. Afaf Nasher, AFAF NASHER, Council on American Islamic Relations, New York Chapter.
Hello, my name's Albert Kahn. I'm the legal director for CARE New York. A man boarded a bus to bring bigotry to our city, and armed with the hatred in his heart and the knife in his hand, he killed Timothy Caughman. This was not just murder. This was not just a hate crime. This was terrorism. But New Yorkers have proven time and again that we will not be terrified into submission. This terrorist targeted our city in the hopes of gaining attention, and we must not reward him. At the very moment that we gather to remember Timothy Caughman and remember this attack, we must pledge to forget the name of the man who killed him. We must, this man thought he could find fame, but his name will die off and Timothy Caughman's name will live on. Timothy Caughman was a born and raised New Yorker. He was a native of Queens, a Brooklyn College grad. He spent much of his life fighting poverty, helping people. And in the last moments of a life spent helping others, he asked the man who killed him, "Why are you doing this?" But today, we have far too few answers. We don't know if the man who killed Timothy Caughman was self-radicalized. We don't know if he was a member of a larger hate group. Was he one of the many growing white supremacist terror organizations that have been documented across this country? But most importantly, we do not know what the NYPD will do to protect the people of New York from the growing white supremacist threat. The Office of Inspector General showed that no more than 5% of the NYPD's budget for investigations, for intelligence, was spent on white supremacists. No more than 5%. That is unacceptable in a day and age when a man can be killed by a white supremacist terrorist in the heart of Midtown Manhattan. We call on the NYPD to do more. And we call on the people of New York to gather each and every time we see one of our neighbors struck down by hatred and by terror. Thank you.
If Thank you. And I think that stat is so important that you just gave us, because hate groups that grow in this country are no different than terrorist groups that grow in other countries. And right. And we must start connecting the dots, and we cannot continue to ignore them. We want to also bring on Reverend L, your team.
Thank you. My name is Reverend Khadr El Yateem from Salam Arabic Lutheran Church in Brooklyn, New York. Brothers and sisters, we come together as people of color with our partners to confront the scandalous reality of hate and racism in this country. That our brother Timothy was the victim of it, and he was killed because of the hate and racism that continue to be embedded in our community, in our country, and we see it on the rise because of the current administration in the White House. We come together to lift our prayers for a man who lived his life and went about doing his own business to find himself faced with a person who is filled with anger and hate that he took his life away from him. We live in America, and in America you should not be victimized, harassed, or killed for the language you speak or the way you look. So today, as people of color, we come and stand together in solidarity with all our partners to confront this scandalous reality that continue to victimize and kill people of color, that every day they face this in their daily life. So today, in behalf of my brother clergy everywhere, we lift our prayer for our brother Timothy. May God bless him, may he rest in peace, and may God comfort his family and his friends, and offer all of us the courage to do what is right in this time and in this place. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much. And the councilman, Robbie Carnegie, who we spoke last night, and immediately he mobilized the caucus as well. Robbie Carnegie, the councilman.
Thank you, Borough President.
Thank you.
So, good afternoon. So, I'm here today, and I'm going to keep my remarks brief, but I'm going to try to make it hyper-local. They said all politics is local, so I'm going to make this hyper-local. Last night, I was in a senior center and with some Black American seniors, and we were discussing this whole incident, and they said something that broke my heart. They said that to them, this was reminiscent of a time in this very century when white supremacists could run into any community that they felt that they could and drag you out by your ankles, i.e. Emmett Till, and kill with no fear of reprisal. Well, I stand here to say that in this very century, what we're calling on NYPD is to set a standard for a fear of reprisal. We have to change the narrative that this is acceptable. Our current administration and our president has used rhetoric and sent out a silent dog whistle in that Make America Great statement. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. Black men have talked quietly about what that means to us, mm-hmm. and it gives us a sour feeling in our stomach. Because to those people that hear that dog whistle, it activates, what he's did, I'm gonna use terrorist rhetoric. What he's done is activated cells in this country that have existed for centuries, but under past administrations have felt themselves relegated to being in the shadows. His rhetoric has brought them from the shadows to the point that they can be blatantly racist and not only say that they do not like Black people, but kill indiscriminately and then surrender themselves because they understand that we operate in a system upstate that they'll be taken care of upstate New York because some of the most racist practices are done upstate New York. Some of the most racist and radicalized Americans live very close to us. So we don't got to go travel very far south to find radicalized Americans who are willing to sacrifice themselves in this way, either to be killed or to be imprisoned for the rest of their lives to make a statement. The act of terrorism by discrimination, what he did fit all of the description of terrorism as defined in a dictionary, by committing an act that was done just to suppress a people. So his act, he came to New York because it's the number one media market in the country. And he committed that act so that people, he could send a resounding message from those cells as what could be done, so that we would cower. So I'm glad to see that there's no cowering here today as it relates to black men. I want to thank my borough president for always, I love Brooklyn, man. I want to thank my borough president for always standing on the forefront and getting us together and letting us operate in a consistency and showing our faces as black men who will not stand for this and who will demand from law enforcement the necessary measures to protect us. Under the Constitution, we are required to be able to be protected under the law. We should be protected. We should feel safe not only in our homes but in our streets. And the idea that somebody could travel this far to send a resounding message should be met with the same force that he brought here. Yes. So I'm calling on NYPD with my borough president to make a resounding statement on what we'll do to push back on that. We're gonna be meeting hopefully this afternoon with the police commissioner to discuss the set of circumstances that will be available to us going forward. So I just wanna thank my borough president and all of these beautiful black men who are out here today, from the clergy, from the community, who are willing to stand up and show that we will not be marginalized and killed indiscriminately in this way. Thank you. Well said.
Because I think that is important to note that, and we appreciate our coalition of Muslims and Jewish and other groups, but you know, as black men, we know we have a responsibility and obligation not to remain silent. And we're very clear on that. And that is why, as black men, we wanted to come out. And we have black educators, black attorneys, black ex-law enforcement, black clergy, black accountants. As black men, we know the history of America. And I want to assure you that we are not going to simply allow someone to burn a cross on our yard. We're not going to simply stand by and allow someone to put a knife in our back. We are not going to simply dangle from a tree in America with our necks broke. That is not happening this century. As black men, that will not happen. We will assure that that will not happen. And I think it's important to hear from some of our young people, a young pastor, Bishop Lamar Whitehead, one of the young pastors that pastored the hip-hop generation.
I want to thank my mentor, the Brooklyn Borough President, for always standing in the gap for our black community. My father in 1978 was brutally beat and strangled to death by 16 police officers. And not saying that officers are bad because they're good, but it was the mindset and the mentality that he's a black man and we can get away with it. Being a bishop to the community and the hip hop community, I'm able to speak to gang members, rappers, and have conversations. And a lot of the conversations that they have with me is the fear of being black, being ostracized, being not understood, being able to be stabbed and killed and a person get away with it. I deal with young men that's in prison. And I got a letter 2 days ago. A young man got accused, falsely accused of robbery. He's facing 75 years. He is sentenced to 75 years and he has 25 years in. And he said, Bishop, as a black man, I was illegally convicted. And I will not see the parole board until I'm 103 years old. Gang members, Bloods and Crips, I'm able to talk to them. And they say, Bishop, what are we gonna do? Nobody wants to hear our voice. They don't wanna hear because we're black. So just to give you the ideology and the mindset of young black men, just to give you the understanding of my point of view, without having a mentor like the Brooklyn Borough President to guide me and navigate me, because I grew up without a father. I didn't understand how to be a man. I didn't understand how to be a black man. So therefore, this strength right here that you see, we gotta stand for something or we're gonna fall for everything. We are black. I can't rub this off. Anyone that's of another nationality or race, don't be mad at me because God blessed me with this pigmentation. Don't be mad at me that God favored us to be such kings and queens. It's not our fault, it's the favor of the Lord. So I just want to say this to you in closing. I'm standing with the Brooklyn Borough President. My name is Bishop Lamar Whitehead. I stand with the youth, the hip hop community. I stand, and anytime someone disrespect or isolate us as animals, you will see our face over and over again. The hip hop community has the Brooklyn Borough President back all the way. I've been on phone calls and they've been out of town. They wanted to be here, but we will get together and we will have a movement with the hip hop community to show the strength of what black individuals or black race can do. God bless you guys.
Thank you. Another councilman has joined us, Councilman King.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Borough President, for calling us all today. I'll be brief, but I'm going to get to the point. I've always said America's always been built on a racial divide, and we tend to ignore that. It's white and black in America. Everything else, we fill in the gaps. Since the inception of this Constitution of the United States of America, we've never been on an equal playing field in America. When a man thinks that it's okay, a white man thinks it's okay to come up and kill another black man, let's call it for what it is. The history of this country has had horrible race relationships. And while we're in the city of New York, we want to ally because we're having kumbaya moments and we all want to get together. Hey, go to the back roads of Georgia. Head back down to Idaho. Go into Alabama and find out hell, go down to Wall Street from time to time and find out how blacks and whites treat each other. That's the real conversation. If we want to ever want to change this, I want to thank the city council because one of the things that we did last November was call on Congress to change the Constitution to negate the 3/5 clause in the Constitution that says that blacks in America are 3/5 of a human being. You want to know why race relationships are hard? Because that same language still exists in the Constitution today. We still treat each other. I don't care how we think we passed some laws or we got 40 acres. I'm still searching for my 40 acres. Who got my mule? That's the reality of what we're dealing with right now. So when we talk about a white man think it's okay to kill another black man, what happened to Emmett Till? No one was held accountable for. What happened to Romare Graham? No one's been held accountable for. What happened to Eric Garner? No one's been accountable for. Hell, we're not killing each other. It's the white man that's kind of killing another black man, and we got to stand out here and do rallies. Well, the Constitution has not made us equal. Until the Constitution makes us equal, then we can start treating each other equal. And if you violate us like that, then you know what? An eye for an eye. If you think it's okay to kill somebody, you shouldn't go to a country club upstate, get 3 meals and a cot, and be taken care of. No, you should be executed too if you want to execute somebody. That's real talk. No one wants to hear that because you know what? We're the ones that are getting killed. You're not mourning your kids each and every day. You're not out having a press conference because someone killed a little Jewish boy, a little Italian guy, a little Caucasian boy or man. We're out here every other week complaining about the system killing us, and the system said, it's okay, we're going to take care, and no one's ever held accountable. In order for us to change this climate, the next time another black man gets killed, hey, like you done, if a black boy kills somebody, you throw that Caucasian person underneath the bus and throw them underneath the jail if they kill another black man. That's how you start changing behaviors. That's how we start getting respect. And if you want us to stop rallying and fighting, then you know what? Make sure that you take care of us. If you want us to abide by laws of society, then take care of us in this society. That's the only way this is going to work. It's not going to change. Having these press conferences, bringing awareness, you guys are, and I want to thank each and every one of the media outlets who are out here today to cover this because you guys can help change the narrative. You know, when our brother got stabbed, the first issue never came out was his history. His story should have never came out. He was a victim. Not what he'd done 20 years ago, 10 years ago, or his health condition. The perpetrator was supposed to have been thrown underneath the bus, not the victim.
Right.
And you guys were dead wrong. That was dead wrong for reporting that all together. But then again, if you don't look at us as equal in your system, then you will never report the truth as the way it should be reported. So I'm thankful to the brother. Thank you, Mr. Borough President, for putting this together. And we're going to do all I can to make sure our voices stay strong. And we're going to stay strong together as black men in this city.
Thank you. Thank you. And you know, some would hear his voice and see anger.
He's supposed to be angry. You know, when you see an act like this and you don't show a level of passion and anger, then something is wrong with you. He's supposed to be angry. And all these men who are voicing their anger and outrage, you're supposed to. That is a normal human characteristic. So don't apologize for your anger that you are displaying. A innocent black man was stabbed in his back. And we grew up of watching black men hanging from trees, watching black men stripped of their clothing and their genitals cut off, watching pictures of black mothers having their babies cut out of their stomach. We grew up, this is what we grew up. We saw this. And so what you are hearing today is men that are saying, in all of that pain, they are not going to relive that. And so I thank you for your passion that you just shared, because that's the passion we must show if we want to stop this from happening. And so I want to bring up two speakers, Black Lives Matter, representative of Black Lives Matter. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Hawk Newsom, H-A-W-K-N-E-W-S-O-M as in Mary E. I'm the president of Black Lives Matter New York. I thank you to all my brothers and sisters who are not black who are here to support, but I speak directly to these black men who stand beside me. We do not all share the same politics. We do not all share the same beliefs. But an assault on one of us from a racist terrorist is an assault on all of us. Right now, what it will take to defend our communities is unyielding. I said unyielding unity. It is time to put down all our differences and come together to protect our communities. Timothy Caughman died. He was killed by an evil man. The man who killed him, James Jackson, is the face of America. Not the ideal America that everyone speaks for and hopes for, but the real America. The real America that locks up black men by the masses. The real America that allows Eric Garner to die without any justice. The real America that allows Tamir Rice to be shot down without any justice. The real America that allows our sisters like Sandra Bland to be murdered by the police. The real America that allowed Eric Garner to scream, "I can't breathe," 11 times and still be killed by the police. So for us to defend ourselves against the real America, we must engage in self-defense. And if need be, we must arm ourselves. We must protect ourselves, because the people who are coming for us are weaponized. The people who are coming for us brag on social medias about their guns, and they brag about killing niggas. So it's time for us to unite and fight back. When we march in these streets, we chant. When they say get back, we say fight back. When they say get back, we say fight back. Fist up. When they say get back, we say fight back. When they say get back, we say fight back. Thank you, brother.
Thank you. Well said. One of our strong bishops in the community, Bishop Finlayson. Thank you.
First of all, I want to thank our borough president for bringing us together. And like every other speaker, I'm outraged that an innocent black man, Timothy, our brother, was murdered by a racist, evil white man. And I don't understand why this city, this nation is not outraged. Black men are an endangered species in these United States of America, and that has been the case for a very long time. We have to now keep our eyes on the district attorney office here in Manhattan, because to be arrested is one thing, to be indicted is something else, to be convicted is something else, and to serve time is something else. And the history is that you kill a black man and you walk free. And so we said to the district attorney, we are watching you, because we want to make sure that there's a conviction and that this man goes away for the rest of his life. We are in this together and we're not going to take it. Our prayers go out to the family of our brother. And again, we salute our borough president for bringing us together. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Well said. Well said. And really, I wanted to take my time and allow as many of the men here to speak because it is therapeutic not to hold in this anger. You know, this anger has killed us just as much as some of this hatred has killed us. And I wanted folks to hear from you on the whole. And I know one brother that's here that should speak. I hope he didn't leave. Brother Davis, the brother of James Davis. Brother James Davis, he was here as well. And so we're going to now walk across the street. I want to thank some of my union brothers here, 32BJ and Local 371 and the Principal Union. All of these organizations who have come out. We're going to walk across the street at this time and place a memorial flowers over. And I want to thank some of the women who are here, Kathleen Daniels and Amma Jamal, just for coming out and just really showing the support. And all of the groups who are here, who are not African Americans, but who are members of the greatest race alive, and that's the human race.
Yes.
And there's no greater display of your humanity than when something that does not directly impact you, you come out and say it is wrong and you stand with what is right. And to me, that really personifies the hope of America when you have the voices of people who were not the father, the son, the brother of Timothy, but they are part of the same race, and that's the human race, and they say we are going to stand here. Far too many people of goodwill ignored the days of yesteryear. Far too many people of goodwill ignored the concentration camps where millions of Jews were killed. Far too many people ignored the display of Chinese Americans that built our railroad system. Far too many people ignored what happened to our Muslim brothers and sisters. Far too many people ignored what happened during the African-American issues. But today, we all have an opportunity to say we are not going to ignore this hate. This is our opportunity to show what it is to be an American and what American is what we're going to stand for. Now is the time to say what we're going to stand for. And a person plunging a knife in the back of an innocent person is not what we're going to stand for. This is not America. And if we have to say it's not America, if not, others will take place. And Robert Carnegie is right. There are hatred cells living in America that have been reignited, and we have to treat them the same way we treat an ISIS cell. We're going to go across the street and put down flowers to show our respect. For Timothy.
Right. PM. See those flowers right here?
Yes, that's what we're going to do. Succeeded, and now we have to succeed. We have to turn back this tone, this climate, turn back this level of patience, and show what we're going to stand for as a country. I have not given up on this country.